Hi everyone, I'm Chris, and this is TechLast's latest laptop from them, which is their fastest. It is called the T-Bolt 20 Pro. It's powered by Intel's Core i5. It's the 8259U. It is an 8th gen one, so it is, yes, dated. Now this laptop here has 8GB of RAM, 256GB of SATA 3 storage, with expandability, you can add another SSD in this. The battery capacity, 55 watt hours. It has a full spec Type-C port, backlit keyboard, a large touchpad, and our screen on this one, 15.6 inches. It's 60 hertz, full HD, anti-glare. So let's take a look at the TechLast T-Bolt 20 Pro. So inside the box, we do have our power cable, a 57 watt charger, which takes just over 2 hours to fully charge it, Windows user manual, and a warranty card. And then the weight of the T-Bolt 20 Pro, let's take a look. It is 1.88 kilos, pretty much spot on with their claim. And the total travel weight is 2.17 kilos, almost 2.18. Looking at the right side now of the laptop, we do have here a Kensington lock slot, USB 3.0, USB 2.0, headphone jack with mic support, and a micro SD card reader. And like always, this one is just USB 2 spec, so it maxes out at about 23 megabytes per second reads and writes. On the left, status LED, this is our DC in there for charging, HDMI 2.0 spec, which is 4K 60, another USB 3.0, Type-C, now this one is full function, that means data, power delivery, and video out up to 4K 30 is all I'm able to get out of that one. And this is just a data USB 3.0 Type-C port. This little switch here with the status LED, that is to disable the webcam. Along the front of the laptop, there's nothing, and the back here is our exit vent where the hot air from that Core i5 8th gen is going to be blown out the back, 28 watt CPU. Now the thickness measuring right here is approximately 20 millimeters, but this rear rubber foot, which is very large, adds to the height. That's an additional then 8 millimeters, bringing up the total thickness right here to 2.8 millimeters, making it well as thick as some gaming laptops. So standard affair here with the keyboard, it's not a bad keyboard to type on. Now pressing down really hard here in the middle, there really is no flex. It's an average keyboard to type on, like it's not super premium the feeling of it, but the keystrokes are okay, the feedback we do get from it. Travel is only about 1.3 to 1.4 millimeters. You can see a compromise here with our number pad, it's a little cramped. And then the half size arrow keys. Now there is this here, which is a function lock button. That's rather handy to have. Media controls, and yes, it is a backlit keyboard. So it's two stages. You can change that. That's using the function key. You've got the first stage and the second. So just turn off the light for a second. And you can see it does stand out. Now it's actually looking a little worse than what it really is. It's great to have a backlit keyboard, but again, we're seeing an uneven backlighting from it. So you can see backspace here that it's slightly brighter on one side, dull in the middle. The same with over this area too. But all up, it's not too bad of a keyboard. And the touchpad, let's talk a little bit about this one right here. So it's not a glass touchpad. It is very large. And I find the finer movements and the sensitivity are good. And of course, it does support Windows 10 gestures. The lid on this laptop is made out of a brushed alloy, very, very easy to scratch. It does have this plastic on it for transit so it doesn't get scratched up. And the lid can't be opened one-handed. Well, actually it can just be opened up one-handed as you can see right here. Now we've got two loudspeakers and our power button is separated away here from the keyboard, which is good. T-Bolt branding and this palm rest here in this area is made out of plastic. The underside material, this is plastic. We have a screw rider in the middle. This is why the keyboard does not have any bounce or flex to it. It feels quite rigid. And you can see here that giant rubber foot there at the back. So it looks like intake vents right here. There is no easy access hatch to add another SSD or more RAM to it. Right here either side are two downwards firing speakers. So there are the two at the top and then these ones making four in total. And the internal, so a little difficult to get off. You have to unclip and use a pry tool around the edges. So we've got some good and some bad in here. The bad, well this. soldered on RAM, so that's DDR4 spec, 2.4 gigahertz. Wireless card, not upgradable. T-Class brand SATA 3 SSD. We can install one more right here. You can see that can take a 22x80, 55 watt hour battery. A lot of free space. So this is why the keyboard doesn't flex. Another reason, it's got a metal backing behind it. So that's why it does feel quite good. We also have a metal hinge. And around here, there is a bracket to reinforce that, which is quite good. That connects up to the Kensington lock slot, at least there. And you can see the downwards firing larger speakers and then the two little ones at the top. And over to our screen here, 15.6 inches. It's an IPS, 60 hertz, and the maximum brightness, according to my Spider 5 Pro, is about 290 nits. And we're just looking now at its color reproduction here and the coverage. So we've got 48% Adobe RGB, poor, very poor. P3 is 47%, NTSC is 46%, and sRGB of only 64. So it is a poor panel. Now the brightness indoors for light, general office kind of tasks, internet browsing, stuff like that, it's fine, but not for professional use. At least being anti-glare and around 290 brightness, it does look okay here indoors. It's just that color coverage is really bad. And up the top here, we've got our webcam in the top bezel. HD quality, here is a sample. Now this webcam quality is not that good. I've got standard lights on at the moment. I haven't turned my powerful studio lights on, but the frame rate of this video, look at this. You can tell it's not 30 frames per second. It's only about 15 frames per second. The audio is being recorded on those dual array microphones that are either side of the camera, and it does have a status LED to let you know it's on. And if you flick the switch on the left, you can hardwire disable it. So that's wired up. It's not software. It's completely cutting out that camera if you wanted to do so for privacy reasons. Just briefly, a look at the BIOS, which as expected is completely unlocked. We get all the advanced settings, and that includes overclocking menus. So this is where you could undervolt, increase power limits if you wanted to do so. But the trade-off is you will generate more heat and probably run into thermal throttling. So absolutely every setting there is available to us. I would not mess about with any of those settings if you don't know what you're doing. So let's get into Windows now. So T-Bolt 20 Pro here does have 2.4 gigahertz RAM DDR4 spec, and you can see there that it is in dual channel, okay, but only 8 gigabytes. I really wish this did ship out with 16, I think would have been a little bit better. Now we have Windows 10 Pro here, okay, and it's activated with a digital license. There is no problem with that. Now if we take a look in the device manager here at our disk drive that I showed you, it has the TickLast label on it. It's their OHM branded SSD. And these are the speeds here on the right. So it's a SATA 3 drive, unfortunately not NVMe spec, although for some reason I put NVMe here. So I'll remove that because no, it's not. So on first boot, you get about 205 gigabytes free. The wireless card, this is a disappointment. So we have the wireless AC9461, and we should have wireless AX Intel AX200 or 201 card would have been a lot better with Bluetooth 5. This one has a Bluetooth 4 spec. Maximum throughput is about 340 megabits per second, which is all right, but there is no gigabit LAN on board here with this particular laptop, which is a shame. So our processor with the Iris Plus 655 graphics, 28 watts, and you can see right there, we do have it listed 8 times because it has 8 threads. It's a quad core, and 3.8 gigahertz is the maximum turbo with this. This is our Geekbench 5 score here. So just over 1000 points for single core score and over 4000 here for the multi-core score. Cinebench R23 scores, so 3,687 points is not bad at all for the 8259U. Okay, the Core i5, I've seen close to 4,000 and I have not undervolted or increased power limits or any tweaks. This is all 100% stock. So system performance overall seems very quick. So documents, spreadsheets all load up pretty much instantly, no real problems, even large ones. I won't go over that because it's pretty straightforward there. Now, a couple other benchmarks I did run, 3DMark, So this is Firestrike. So under 2,000 points, just under for our graphics score. Not amazing, but for integrated graphics for 8th gen, this was quite good. Of course, now the Iris Xe does perform a lot better than this. And then we do have the Night Raid score here for integrated graphics. Graphics score there just over 8,000. Not too bad. And later on, I will get onto the gaming performance. So I wanted to test out YouTube here in Chrome. I have a 4K test. We'll see how this runs it because we should be able to handle this just fine. I'll enable those stats. The only possible problem really is my internet connection here, but no, that actually seems to be working just fine. Of course, I will full screen this. We'll see the result. So, drop frames, none. Very good. VP9 codec plays it just fine, okay? So, native file playback, VP9 and HEVC. Really no issues at all with that. You can throw everything at the Iris Plus Graphics 655 here, and it just handles it with ease. So a very decent performer, even though now, of course, yes, 8th gen is quite dated. And onto our audio now. So we have a 3.5mm headphone jack with mic support. No complaints from me out of it. It's loud. It does sound quite clean, the audio through it. So right now I'm going to test out these speakers. We've got four in total. The two downwards firing ones are the best. The ones up the top don't really seem to add that much. But hey, at least we have them. They are so far probably the best speakers in a TechLast laptop, but they're still not really that good. So here's that sample at 100% max volume. Okay, video editing now. This is with Adobe Premiere Pro. So the timeline here with the playback resolution set to just 1/4 is fine, okay? It drops frames occasionally, but really for the maximum performance, you do need a dedicated GPU. Even though the integrated GPU, this one, the Iris Plus 655, more potent than what we have seen on previous or other 8th gen, it's not too bad, the timeline here. But still not the fastest. So export times for 1 minute of footage, which I will select. This will be with the YouTube preset. We'll see how long it is going to take. Normally this is just over a minute. There we go. So that was approximately 1 minute and 52 seconds or so. So just 2 minutes. So almost double time here. Not the fastest result I have seen. Counter-Strike now, so how will it game here with that Iris graphics, which is the Iris Plus 655? So we're getting a frame rate here about 60 frames per second. And yeah, a few little dips right there. So I won't torture you too long here with my terrible gameplay. I tend to die pretty quick anyway. So the performance here with that smoke, that grenade just going off with the flames and everything did dip down, but it's all right here considering this is integrated graphics, the 8th gen. It used to be really good, but it's been superseded, of course, by that Iris Xe graphics. So I'm just going to charge in here. Oh, I can't believe I didn't actually get a kill there. I must have surely hit him. I didn't see him at first. All right. Oh, well, I'm dead. Let's take a look now at GTA 5, how that's going to run. So, by the way, Counter-Strike here was 1080p, lowest possible settings. And GTA 5 here, I have set to the normal level of settings. So the population density, view distance, and that other one is set to the middle. And you can see it's not even 30 frames per second here at 1080p. So it's just too demanding. So you really need to run this game in 720p. Then you get around 40 frames per second, making it, well, semi-playable. I mean, if you're used to playing this on older last-gen consoles, then that's pretty much the frame rate we had anyway, around 30 frames per second. So you could say that, yeah, I mean, look, we're getting 30 now. It's, yeah, kind of playable. Not too bad, but really, I'd love to have 60 frames per second, but the Iris Plus graphics simply cannot do it. Onto our thermals now and fan noise. So unfortunately, it gets up to 93 degrees C here, as you can see. And it does trigger thermal throttling, affecting the performance a little bit once it gets up to those temperatures. Now, I have been pushing it very hard for 1 hour now, so that's been benchmarking gaming. That's pretty much the hottest it will get. Now, above the keyboard is actually very good, the temperatures, so no problems with that. Fan noise is excellent too. It's just a minor little whooshing noise you can hear there in the background. It does not get super loud at all. So that's the positive, but the negative, yes, it did throttle. Now onto our Linux support. So just very briefly, I wanted to point out that it works just fine on this particular T-Bolt 20 Pro laptop. Audio controls are working, the touchpad is working fine, wireless is working. So everything does work here with a new distro. As long as you've got a new one, the drivers will all be supported. This is an old Wi-Fi chip, so no issues whatsoever with drivers. And yeah, it does run really well on this spec of laptop. And now our battery life. So at 30% brightness, the screen, and just doing light work relatively close to my wireless router, I was able to get just over 7 hours. That's just YouTube and just doing very, very light kind of work. Now, if you step it up to mixed use and you're doing something that's a little bit more demanding, then the battery life will drop down to about 5 hours. If you're gaming or video editing, you're looking at about 2.5 hours with only a 55 watt hour battery. And it is a rather powerful 28 watt chip that can use up to 55 watts or so at its peak there. So the backlit keyboard, it is nice. It is like an Acer or Asus keyboard from about 2, 3, 4 years ago laptops, the medium or entry level laptops from them, that is. Touchpad, not bad at all. Finer movements are great because the cursor does not jump all over the place. It is a usable touchpad, which is good. So plastic palm rest, plastic on the bottom, and then the lid is metal. The hinge is good. It's quite stiff. It goes all the way back. It is a metal hinge and not bad. The screen, as I pointed out, is disappointing. So this is only 290 nits and the color coverage there, the gamut, it's not good at all, okay? So not for professional use, not for editing photos or video this. Even though the spec of laptop is good for that, it's quite powerful. So you can edit 4K video, you can do a lot of Photoshop, things like that with this. It has that power. So the non-expandability is quite disappointing for the RAM. Okay, we can't add an extra SODIMM and bring it up to 16 gigabytes. That's a disappointment. We can add an additional NVMe drive in this, which I do like. But on the bottom of it, where is that quick and easy access, single screw, a little hatch to then install a secondary NVMe drive? No, you have to remove the whole rear cover, which is a hassle. It's probably just a one-off job you will do, but still, it's not for everyone. A lot of screws, and then it's clipped in quite hard. You need to use a pry tool. There's risk of damaging it. And why is the boot drive SATA 3 and not NVMe? I guess they saved the faster spec for the expandable storage. Not great. So Wi-Fi AX, it should be AX, but we've got Wi-Fi AC. So Wi-Fi 5 spec with only a single antenna to it. I still managed to achieve over 300 megabits per second transfers, but really they need to be on the latest generation of Wi-Fi, I feel, with a laptop like this. Now the pricing of this one here, how is it? I think it's too expensive. So 580 euros at the time of me recording this review is a bit too much. That's too steep for me for a brand like this, considering the fact that if you spend just a little more, at least here in Europe, you can get a 11th gen Intel Core i5 laptop with a very similar spec to it, with probably better build quality and probably even a better screen. So there we go, that is the full story of TechLast's new T-Bolt 20 Pro. Thank you so much for watching.